Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 1st of January 2020. On behalf of Shankar IAS Academy and the Civil Speeda team, I wish you all a very happy new year. Today, we will be seeing news articles based on different areas such as geography, history, polity, international relations, etc. So for that, these are the news articles that we have chosen today. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping for the displayed articles are given in the description box. And for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Let's move on to our first news article analysis. This discussion is based on this news article and this picture, which is about the forest fires. The syllabus that is relevant for this analysis is given here for your reference. This picture depicts the bushfires at Sydney in Australia, which happened on Tuesday. You would have heard in news that more than 200 forest fires are burning across the state of New South Wales and the state of Victoria in Australia. Not only this, we have also seen a massive forest fire in the Amazon rainforest this year. So throughout the year, from Brazil to Australia and from California to Indonesia, massive wildfires have torn through vast areas of forest. So in this way, it becomes important for us to discuss about the forest fires. The forest fires are also known as wildfires or bushfires. It is defined as the uncontrolled fires which occur in fields, grass and bush as well as in the forest itself. Based on its importance, even the recently released India State of Forest Report of 2019 also has a whole dedicated chapter to this problem of forest fires. Yesterday, we have covered about this report in detail. You can have a look at it for better understanding. But today, we will just focus on the chapter of forest fires from this report. Now, these forest fires are important because they are known as one of the important causes of loss of biodiversity. The other causes are biotic pressure and climate change. In addition to this, the forest fires are one of the major drivers of damage that is caused to forests in the country. If the forest fires are uncontrolled, then they can lead to significant losses of forests and ecosystem services. And according to some scientific studies, climate change influences the forest fire frequency and intensity. And this results in forests becoming increasingly inflammable. See, in this, the increasing duration of forest fire season, then number of large fires, then frequency of severe fire years may be related to the climate change. Now, apart from the direct losses, foresters have to also deal with many side effects of forest fires. Some side effects are increasing spread of weeds, then soil erosion, then loss of regeneration, then landslides, habitat degradation, then loss of forest produce, etc. So this means there is a high need for reducing the forest fires to the minimum. So for this, we need forest fire management. Now, recognizing this need, the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change of our Government of India came up with the National Action Plan on Forest Fires of 2018. One of the main objectives of this action plan is to reduce the incidences of fires by informing, by enabling and by empowering forest fringe communities and also by incentivizing them to work alongside with the state forest departments. This plan also aims to reduce the vulnerability of forests against the fire hazards across the diverse forest ecosystems in the country. And this will be done by enhancing the capabilities of institutions in fighting fires and by accelerating the recovery after a fire incident. And this plan particularly proposes 9 strategies to address the issue. And one of these strategies is establishment of a Center of Excellence on Forest Fire Management at the Forest Survey of India. Then the National Plan also acknowledges the role of Forest Survey of India in providing timely forest fire alerts to the state forest departments and to the communities. Now, these forest fire alerts are disseminated by the Forest Survey of India, and this is based on the inputs from 2 collaborative arrangements between NASA ISRO and ISRO FSI. For providing the forest fire alerts, the fire hotspots are detected first. For this purpose, 2 satellite systems are used. One is MODIS and the other is SNPP-VIIRS. That is Moderate Resolution Imaging Spectroradiometer, and then SWOMI National Polar Orbiting Partnership -Visible Infrared Imaging Radiometer Suite. Now, the comparison of these 2 satellite systems is provided here for your reference. Now, the fire hotspots, which are detected by these two satellite systems, are received at a Earth station of National Remote Sensing Center. And then it is processed using NASA's algorithm. And in this representation, you can see how the forest fire alert system works. Now, based on this, an analysis of fire-prone forest areas was carried out by the FSI. And the findings of this analysis has emerged from the forest fire points that were identified across the country from the year 2004 to 2017. And the forest fire points that were identified during this 13-year period adds up to more than 2,77,000. And further, the findings of this study indicate that nearly 4% of the country's forest cover is extremely prone to fire, whereas 6% of the forest cover is found to be very highly fire prone. And more than 36% of the country's forest cover has been estimated prone to frequent forest fires. And from this data, we can say that about 21.40% of the forest cover of the country is highly to extremely fire prone. And if you look at this map, it shows the fire prone forest areas in the country under different categories. That is under extreme fire prone, very highly fire prone, moderately fire prone, less fire prone. Now from this, you can see that most of the fire prone forest areas are found in the northeastern region and the central part of the country. And among the northeastern region, Mizoram is most extremely fire prone. It is because about 30% of total forest cover in Mizoram are of extremely fire prone forest areas. Even you can see this clearly in this map, because you can see the dark red spots more in Mizoram. So what is the reason for these most forest fires in the northeastern region? According to a scientist of Zoological Survey of India, one of the major reasons for forest fires in the northeast is the slash and burn cultivation. This slash and burn cultivation is commonly called as jhoom cultivation or jhoom cultivation. In this jhoom cultivation, the jungle is cleared in the dry months before the monsoon starts. Here the trees and the shrubs are cut, and the entire plot with the trees and shrubs is allowed to dry for a month or so. And before the rains, the plot is set on fire and the ash-covered burnt soil is thoroughly hoed and mixed with the ash. And after this, the cultivation is done. And that is why we say it is a slash and burn cultivation. Even some of the other reasons for forest fires are mostly man-made, according to the scientists. And this is most common where people visit forests and leave burning bidis, cigarette stubs and other inflammable materials. Now you may have a question that whether all the reasons for these forest fires are man-made. Actually no, there are many natural reasons also. And one of the natural reason is thunderstorms. Because we know that thunderstorm is a violent, short-lived weather disturbance that is almost always associated with lightning, thunder, dense clouds, heavy rain and strong and gusty winds. So in a thunderstorm, there is lightning. And this lightning sets the trees on fire. And this leads to the forest fires in the forest areas. So in this discussion, we discussed about the forest fires and which are the areas in India which are prone to forest fires and what are the reasons behind these forest fires. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. Moving on to the next discussion. This discussion is based on the Bhima Koregaon battle. The syllabus that can be linked to this discussion is given here for your reference. The news article mentions that today is the 202nd anniversary of the Bhima Koregaon battle. Originally, the battle was fought on 1st January 1818. This Bhima Koregaon battle was a part of Anglo-Maratha Wars. So in this context, we'll see about the Maratha Kingdom, then about the Anglo-Maratha Wars and the significance of the Bhima Koregaon battle in the present context. The Maratha Kingdom was founded by Chhatrapati Shivaji, and at that time, Raigad was the capital of the Maratha Kingdom. And Shivaji was a contemporary of Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb. Chhatrapati Shivaji and the successors of the Maratha Kingdom expanded their territory because of their able administration. And in their rule, the Peshwas were known as the prime ministers. The Peshwas ruled the Maratha Kingdom's expanded territory with their local chiefs. And this expanded territory was known as Maratha Confederacy. And by the end of 1760, the Maratha Kingdom emerged as one of the strongest kingdoms with Pune as its capital. as you can see in this map. However, in the third battle of Panipat, which took place on 14 January 1761, the Marathas were defeated in the hands of Afghan invader Ahmed Shah Abdali. Then after the third battle of Panipat, the influence of Maratha kingdom started to decline. During the last years of 18th century, the influence of the Marathas further declined. It is because of the rise of British rule and also because of the defeat of the Marathas in the Anglo-Maratha wars. See, there were three Anglo-Maratha wars and they were fought between 1777 and 1818. These wars were fought between British East India Company and the Maratha Confederacy. And the reason for these wars were growing interference of British in the internal matters of the Maratha Confederacy. And one of the reasons was the British greed for territorial expansion. And another reason was to check the power of Marathas. These wars were fought. And in this, the first war, that is the first Anglo-Maratha war, was fought between 1775 and 1782. So it ended in 1782 with the Treaty of Salbai. In this war, there was no clear victory either for Marathas or British. Then happened the Second Anglo-Maratha War. It happened in 1803 to 1805. In this war, Marathas lost majority of their territory to British. As a result of this, British gained Orissa and the territories which were north of the Yamuna River, including Agra and Delhi. After this came the third and the final Anglo-Maratha War. The two main causes that led to the third and the final conflict between the British and the Marathas were the growing desire of the Marathas to get back their lost territories. There was one other reason also. It was the excessive British control over the Maratha chiefs. So to tackle this situation, the third and the final Anglo-Maratha war was fought. In this final war, the British East India Company emerged as victorious because of their superior military, and the British East India Company crushed the rule of Marathas. And as a result, the Peshwa was removed and sent away to Bittur near Kanpur with a pension. But our today's discussion is about the Bhima Koregaon battle. Now, this battle was fought as a part of the Third Anglo-Maratha War. This battle was fought at the Bhima Koregaon village, which is situated on the banks of Bhima River in Pune district of Maharashtra. The Bhima Koregaon battle was fought between the forces of Peshwa and the British East India Company on 1st January 1818. In this battle, the British army comprised primarily of Dalit soldiers and the Peshwa army had an upper caste domination. But this battle was won by the Dalit dominated British troops as they defeated the Peshwa army. Now, to commemorate this battle, a memorial pillar was erected by the British. This memorial pillar is known as the Koregaon Ranstam or the Vijay Ranstam, which translates to a victory pillar. So, after passing several years, particularly in the recent decades, Bhima Koregaon battle has assumed significance. It has become a symbol in Maharashtra for celebrating Dalit pride. As the Bhima Koregaon battle was fought in 1818, 2018, which was 2 years before, marked the 200th anniversary of the victory of Bhima Koregaon battle. And this year marks the 202nd anniversary. So to mark this occasion, a large number of people from different states visit the Koregaon Ranstam to pay homage. And this is what the news article mentions. So in this news article, we discussed about the Bhima Koregaon battle, about the Maratha kingdom, and about the three Anglo-Maratha wars and the significance of the Bhima Koregaon battle in the present scenario. With this, we come to the end of this news article discussion. The rest plate practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion. This discussion is about the Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020. In this area, there are different news articles in three editions today. So in this discussion, we will be seeing about Swachh Sarvekshan 2020. Then about the Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020 and the different categories of ranking for this Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. We know that the Swachh Bharat mission was launched in 2014 for a 5-year period. And the objective of the Swachh Bharat mission was to achieve 100% open defecation free status in India. And it had two components. One is Swachh Bharat urban and then is Swachh Bharat Gramin. And in this, our today's focus will be on Swachh Bharat Urban. The target of this Swachh Bharat Urban is creating urban India open defecation free, which is clearly stated in its objective that the Swachh Bharat Urban Mission is to achieve 100% open defecation free status and 100% solid waste management in all urban local bodies. And also, as we know, this is implemented by the Union Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. If you see, in December 2019, the Union Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs has said that Swachh Bharat Mission Urban has achieved its target of creating Urban India ODF, that is open defecation free. It states that the urban areas of 35 states or union territories have become open defecation free. Now, to enhance this status and to make the cities to compete with each other in a positive spirit, an innovative survey is being conducted every year since 2016, and it is conducted by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. And obviously, it is conducted under Swachh Bharat Mission Urban. Now, this survey is called as the Swachh Sarvekshan. And in this, we know Swachh means cleanliness and Sarvekshan means survey. Now, this survey focuses on different parameters every year. And you can see these different parameters in this picture. If you see, in the last survey, the focus was on sustainability. And this year, the objective of the Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020 is sustaining the on-ground performance of cities along with continuous monitoring of service level performance in cleanliness. So, this year's focus is to institutionalize Swachhata, which means to make cleanliness as a norm. Here, if you see, we are using two different terms. One is Swachh Sarvekshan 2020 and the other one is Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020. In this, the Swachh Sarvekshan 2020 is the annual survey which is scheduled to happen from 4th January 2020 till 31st January 2020. And the Swachh Sarvekshan League is a part of this Swachh Sarvekshan 2020. If you see in this picture, the Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020 carries only 25% of weightage. Apart from this, equal weightage of 25% each is given to citizens' feedback, direct observation and certification of cities. So, remember that Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020 is not a final ranking of the cities. It is a part of Swachh Sarvekshan 2020. The main idea of having this Swachh Sarvekshan League is to continuously assess the service level progress of the cities so as to sustain the ODF status. So now you may be thinking, what is this league? See, league literally means group. Now, until last year, the survey was conducted once in a year. But this year, as part of this Swachh Sarvekshan 2020, continuous assessment was made with the help of Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020. And it was conducted in three quarters, April to June 2019, July to September 2019, October to December 2019. So, it was done in groups. That is the reason why it is called as Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020. Now, in this League 2020, the entire focus is to assess the service level progress of solid waste management. This includes various components that are involved in solid waste management, like transportation and collection of solid waste, then processing and disposal of solid waste, then sustainable sanitation, then capacity building, etc. And in this, the ranks for cities have been assigned in two categories. One category is for the cities with population of 1 lakh and above. And this category is further divided into two subcategories. One is cities with 10 lakh population and above, and then the cities with 1 to 10 lakh population. Then the second category is the cities with population of less than 1 lakh. Under this category, the rankings are given zone wise and population wise. There are 5 zones: north, east, west, south, and northeast. And the population categories are less than 25,000, then 25,000 to 50,000, and then 50,000 to 1 lakh. Apart from this, rankings have also been given for the cantonment boards in India. Now, we know that cantonment board is a corporate body under the Cantonment Act of 2006. And as you have seen, cantonment is a place where the soldiers and their families live. So, this cantonment board is a civic administration body. So, that is why they have also been included in this ranking. And then finally, an overall composite ranking is also provided, which includes all the categories including the cantonment boards. So, in this context, the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs has released the results for the first two quarters, that is for quarter 1 and quarter 2. As you can see in this table, the urban local bodies from the states of Gujarat and Madhya Pradesh have dominated the rankings of both these quarter 1 and quarter 2. And among the cities with more than 10 lakh population, Indore city, which is located in Madhya Pradesh, has topped the list. And the Indore city has topped both in quarter 1 and quarter 2. And under the category of cities with 1 to 10 lakh population, the city of Jamshedpur, which is located in Jharkhand, has been ranked the first. Then in this news article, it is mentioned that the Bengaluru urban local body has got a better ranking than 2018. And this was achieved by the various initiatives taken by the Bengaluru urban local body. It had taken steps to treat the leachate. Here, leachate is a liquid that passes through a landfill and has extracted dissolved and suspended matters from it. So they have taken steps to treat this leachate, and they have introduced biometric attendance for all workers to ensure they work regularly and the cleanliness is ensured. And they have also appointed marshals to check indiscriminate dumping of waste. Then it has provided handheld machines to levy spot fines, those who violate the rules. And even some steps have been taken to set up a state-of-the-art smart control room for solid waste management. Even this news article mentions that this Bengaluru urban local body received the ODF tag for the first time. So this means the initiatives taken by the Bengaluru urban local body has been successful. So it can be used by other cities and urban local bodies also. So that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about Swachh Sarvekshan 2020, then about Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020, and we also saw which city topped in the ranking of Swachh Sarvekshan League 2020. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The split practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next news article discussion. This discussion is based on a Supreme Court verdict on transfer of community resources. The syllabus that can be linked to this discussion is given here for your reference. We know that in order to enjoy life in its fullest sense, every person needs certain resources, such as we need fresh air, clean water, clean environment, education, health, etc. And among the resources, the most important resources are the community resources. These community resources are the resources that can improve the quality of life of an entire community in a particular area. For example, ponds, lakes, fresh air, clean environment, etc. are community resources. So, it shall be the duty of every citizen as well as the duty of the state to protect, to preserve and to carefully use the community resources. Now, this was recognized by the lawmakers, so they have inserted related provisions in the Constitution for this purpose. One of such provision is provided in the fundamental duties under Article 51, Capital A. This article provides for certain moral obligations on the citizens of India. Particularly, Article 51, Capital A, Clause G says that it shall be the duty of every citizen of India to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, and wildlife, and to have compassion for living creatures. Based on this only, we are saying it shall be the duty of every citizen to protect, preserve, and carefully use the community resources. Now, we know that the fundamental duties are non-justiciable, but even though we are under moral obligation to obey them. Here, non-justiciable means if these duties are violated, then they cannot be taken to court for enforcement. So, in this sense, always remember that fundamental rights are enforceable, but fundamental duties and directive principles of state policies are non-enforceable. Now, the next such provision is Article 48A. This article comes under the Directive Principles of State Policies. This article states that the state shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard the forests and wildlife of the country. Hence, by this we can say that the state is also under a moral obligation to preserve the environment so that it will result in the welfare of its citizens. So, these are the constitutional provisions that you should know with respect to the protecting, preserving and carefully using of community resources. Now, today's news is that the Supreme Court has given a verdict on transfer of community resources. The Supreme Court verdict is based on a plea by an environmental activist. The plea was against the transfer of certain village ponds and sites in the National Capital Region to some private industrialists. This transfer was done by the Greater Noida Industrial Development Authority. So, in this matter, the Supreme Court has ordered the authorities and the industrialists to remove all obstructions and to restore the water bodies within 3 months. Now, this judgment and some of the observations made by the Supreme Court in this judgment is important for us. The Supreme Court has noted that the transfer of invaluable community resources like village water ponds to a few powerful people and to industrialists for the commercialization of property are grossly illegal. Now, Supreme Court made this point on the basis that many areas of the country perennially face water crisis and they already have inadequate access to drinking water. And if the water ponds are transferred to powerful people and industrialists for commercialization, then the water resources will deplete more. The Supreme Court further observed that common areas or resources are the lifeline of village communities. These common areas often sustain various chores and provide necessary resources for life. They are also the life for local flora and fauna. Hence, the protection of such village commons is essential to safeguard the fundamental right guaranteed by Article 21 of our Constitution. Now, this point is based on the basis that water bodies are an important source of fishery and they are also needed to have potable water, that is drinking water. So, the water bodies provide necessary resources to lead a life. And even our Article 21 declares that no person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to procedure established by law. Now, this right is available to both citizens and non-citizens that we know. And in particular, in the Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India case of 1978, the Supreme Court had given a wider interpretation of Article 21. It ruled that the right to life and personal liberty of a person can be deprived by a law provided the procedure prescribed by that law is reasonable, fair and just. In other words, the Supreme Court had introduced the concept of due process of law. So, the protection under Article 21 is available against arbitrary legislative and executive actions. And transferring of village ponds and sites to private industrialists is an arbitrary executive action according to the Supreme Court. That is why Supreme Court has said that it is against Article 21 of our Constitution. The Supreme Court further observed that the state cannot deprive villagers of their existing source of water, even if it promises to provide them an alternative site where the water body can be replicated. Now, in this, the Supreme Court noted that this particular attitude will display a mechanical application of environmental protection. The Supreme Court noted this because it simply means that a water body is much more than a mere means for providing water. A water body is a part of the life of people who are living nearby. Life of local flora and fauna, etc. So, based on this, the court observed that even if an alternate water body is formed, there is no guarantee that the adverse effects of destroying the existing water body would be offset or it would be diminished. And also, if such an alternate water body is formed, then it will compel the people to travel miles to access the alternative site. So, based on this, Supreme Court noted that authorities and the powerful people should not encroach upon common lands for their personal aggrandizement. That is, they should not encroach upon common lands for the increase of their own power or wealth. So, these are the information that you should know from this news article. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The split practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, this news article is related to the Nadandai Vaali Kaveri project. The syllabus that can be linked to this discussion is given here for your reference. In this discussion, we will discuss the objectives of this Nadandai Vaali Kaveri project and then we will discuss about the river Kaveri. This Nadandai Vaali Kaveri is a project of Tamil Nadu government. Now, in this, Nadandai Vaali Kaveri means eternal Kaveri. This project aims to abate pollution. It aims to conserve and rejuvenate Kaveri and its main tributaries on the line of Namami Gange program. As we know, this Namami Gange program also aims to rejuvenate a river, which is the river Ganga. So, on the same lines, this Nadandai Vaali Kaveri aims to conserve and rejuvenate river Kaveri and its main tributaries. The project includes riverfront development such as afforestation along the banks, developing recreational areas, etc. And it also includes building sewage treatment plants to augment the existing capacity. And it also includes river surface cleaning. According to this news article, the estimated cost of this project is more than 11,000 crores. So, for this, the state government was expecting central financial assistance so that the state government can successfully complete the project. But according to this news article, the center was appreciative of the idea of rejuvenating Kaveri, but it did not commit for financial assistance. That is why the news article mentions that the center is unlikely to fund the Kaveri project. So, that was about the news article. Now, in this context, it becomes important to know the geographical aspects of this river Kaveri. You know that the Kaveri River is also known as Ponni in Tamil. It originates in Talakaveri, which is located in Brahmagiri Hills of Western Ghats in the Kodagu district of Karnataka. Then it flows into Tamil Nadu, and on its course, it divides the states into north and south. And finally, it flows into the Bay of Bengal at Pumbuhar in Tamil Nadu, or which is also known as Kaveri Pumpattinam. So from this, you can easily say that Kaveri is an interstate river with a total catchment area of more than 81,150 square kilometers. It's spread over the states of Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu and the Union Territory of Puducherry. Some of the important tributaries of this river Kaveri are Harangi, Hemavati and Arkavati. They are the important left bank tributaries. Then important right bank tributaries are Kabini, Bhavani, Lakshman Tirtha, Noyil and Amravati. And also know that two important waterfalls are located in this river Kaveri. They are Sivasamudram Falls and Hoggenekkal Waterfalls. And in this, Sivasamudram Falls is located in Karnataka and Hoggenekkal Waterfalls is located in Tamil Nadu. Then there are also some important dams over Kaveri. They are Krishnarajasagar Dam, then Metur Dam, then the Grand Aniket Dam, which is also known as Kallani Dam. Now in this, you should note that the Kallani Dam is originally constructed by the Chola King Karigalan or Karigala Cholan, and it was constructed in the 2nd century AD. So these are the important geographical aspects that you should know about this Kaveri River. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The split practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the last discussion for the day, which is based on this editorial. This editorial talks about the terrorist attacks in the country of Somalia. The syllabus that can be linked to this discussion is given here for your reference. There was a recent terrorist attack in Somalia, which happened on December 28, 2019. It happened in the Somalia's capital, Mogadishu. And this terrorist attack killed at least 79 people and it injured 149 people. And this incident indicates the increasing terrorist threats in Somalia. And this attack was carried out by the terrorist organization Al-Shabaab. Al-Shabaab is the Al-Qaeda-linked terrorist group. This group was driven out from Mogadishu in 2011 by international forces. We will see how later in this discussion. Even before this attack, already in 2017, a similar attack happened, and that attack was considered to be the deadliest attack in the country of Somalia. Now, this organization Al-Shabaab carries out such attacks to undermine the government of Somalia. It is because the government of Somalia is backed by the United Nations and African Union troops. So, in this context, let us see about the brief history of Somalia and Al-Shabaab, which is discussed throughout this editorial. And we'll discuss about the rise and influence of Al-Shabaab over the African country, Somalia. See, Somalia is ethnically, religiously, and linguistically homogeneous country. But the country's population is divided into clans. They have Isaac clan in northwestern Somalia, Havye clan in central Somalia, Ogaden clansmen in South Somalia, etc. So in simple words, we can say that Somalia is ethnically homogeneous, but it is a clan fractured country. And before 1950, during the colonial period, when Somalia was under Italy and Great Britain, the clans of Somalia became a central feature of the state administration and political competition. And then Somalia gained independence around 1950, in which the southern regions of Somalia were under different colonial powers. After the independence, the northern Somaliland and the southern regions were united under multi-party democracy. And this lasted from 1960 to 1969. What happened in 1969 was a bloodless rebellion. This bloodless rebellion resulted in the installment of President Mohammed Sayed Barre. So from 1969 to 1978, the Barre regime enjoyed relative popularity and financial support from both the Soviet Union and also from the Western institutions. But the Barre regime became increasingly oppressive and violent in the late 1970s and also in 1980s. So these instances triggered the withdrawal of vital US support for the Barre regime. This US support came into Somalia by 1992. We will see about this later in this discussion. And the violent and oppressive instances also attracted the sympathy from neighboring countries towards the Somalis. So all this together threatened Barre's regime. So as Barre's regime was weakening, a number of clan-based militias arose to secure control over their respective areas of the country. The Barre regime continued to launch targeted attacks against the civilian population throughout 1990. This resulted in the government to lose the ground, and eventually the government retained control over only some 10-15% of the state territory. So due to this, by January 1991, Barre fled the capital. After the flight of Barre, the inter-clan fighting was more intensified. In the same year, the former British protectorate of Somaliland declared unilateral independence. That is, they self-declared their independence. The Somaliland lies in northwestern Somalia on the southern coast of Gulf of Aden. In addition to this, the inter-clan fightings caused disruptions of the livelihood of agro-pastoral communities. So these incidents altogether resulted in a famine in Somalia that began in 1992. The famine in Somalia paved the way for an international military and humanitarian intervention in Somalia. So a joint US-United Nations forces entered Somalia under the United Task Force banner in December 1992. After this, already continuing fight of inter-clan militia also continued during this period. Now, because of these international interventions, new casualties arose due to the fighting between international forces and Somali militias. And in a Black Hawk Down incident, 18 American soldiers were killed. After this incident, US troops gradually withdrew from Somalia in 1994 and 1995. And during this period was the first time where Al-Shabaab rose from anarchy. That is, they rose by exploiting the chaos and lawlessness that prevailed over the country. And Al-Shabaab spread its influence quite fast across Somalia. It even captured Mogadishu, which is the Somalia's capital. After this incident, the US and African Union troops, which were backing the federal government of Somalia, removed Al-Shabaab. So it created a new conflict between the Al-Shabaab and the internationally backed federal government. Since then, the group has been attacking the government and also attacking the people residing in the government-controlled areas through guerrilla warfare and terror strikes. Not only this Al-Shabaab terrorist organization, even other militant groups including Islamic State faction are also on the rise in the Somalia country. Then after Al-Shabaab was removed by the federal government with the help of international backing, by 1998, the Puntland region, which lies in the northeastern Somalia, declared itself as autonomous state. The region declared it to avoid the clan warfare that was engulfing the southern Somalia. But internationally, Puntland is still recognized as an autonomous region of Somalia only. Then after this, by 2007, African Union troops landed in Somalia's capital, Mogadishu, against the battles between Islamist insurgents and the government forces, which were backed by Ethiopian troops. At the same time, the UN Security Council authorized 6 months peacekeeping mission. So by 2009, Ethiopia withdrew its troops completely. And currently, if you see, security of Somalia is largely taken care of by African Union mission. The African Union mission has stated that it is preparing for condition-based handover of national security responsibility to the Somali government. But in reality, if you see, the security situation is so fragile in the country that it is doubtful whether the Somali government could hold itself together if the international troops pull out of the country. So this was about the political history of Somalia. Now to understand the problems that are engulfing Somalia, we should first know about the present Somalian government. If you see the type of government in Somalia, it is federal in structure. The federal government of Somalia was established in August 2012 and it was established under the federal constitution. So there are 6 federal member states and a Banadir regional administration, which is the Mogadishu municipality. The 6+1 form the federal government. The 6 federal members are Somaliland, Puntland, Galmudug, Heshabel, Southwest State, Jubaland. You can see these states in this map clearly. Then in 2017, Muhammad Abdullahi Farmaho, who is known as Farmaho, was elected as the president of Somalia with the support of African Union mission. And Farmaho also promised to restore Somalia's dignity and to bring peace and reconciliation to the country during his 4-year tenure. So this is about the present Somali government. Now let us discuss the internal and the external problems that are engulfing Somalia. First is that the Farmajo's federal government and the governments of Somalia's six federal states have been unable to overcome their disagreements over the division of power and resources among them. Then the second problem is that the Islamist Al-Shabaab insurgency has proved resilient and they could not be wiped out completely even today. And the third problem is that a standoff between semi-autonomous federal state of Puntland and the self-declared Republic of Somaliland threatens to escalate into an open war. And then final problem is that there is a sharp deterioration of Somali government's relations with the United Arab Emirates. It is because UAE perceives the Somalian government as too close to Qatar. And we know that in July 2017 Gulf crisis, the Gulf countries imposed an economic blockade to Qatar. So it is like whoever the Qatar supports, UAE will not support. And this perception of UAE is true. The Somali government has backing from Qatar and also from Turkey. So because of this, the other Gulf countries, including the UAE, supports and funds the Somalia's federal states. They do not support the Somalian government. So it is expected that the Gulf crisis will further deepen the Somalia's already divided politics and it will further aggravate the tensions between the Mogadishu and the Somali regions. So this was about the brief history and politics of the country Somalia, which was discussed in the editorial. Now let us discuss about the geography of Somalia from prelims point of view. The country of Somalia is located in the Horn of Africa. It is bordered by Ethiopia to the west, the Gulf of Aden to the north, and Kenya to the southwest. And even the country claims a border with Djibouti through the disputed territory of Somaliland. So how Somalia is important? It is strategically important for international trade as it lies along the Red Sea and the Indian Ocean. Even the foreign navies, including those of US and China, have a strong presence in this region. The US also has a huge military base in neighboring Djibouti. And US is using this military base to carry out airstrikes on militants in Somalia. And also the Gulf nations have had trade and religious ties with Somalia for centuries. And today they are fighting over Somalia with the desire to control the Horn of Africa and its waters, because it is close to vital oil routes and its ports could serve the landlocked Ethiopia, which has a population of 100 million. So these are the strategic importance of Somalia. In this discussion, we discussed about the politics of Somalia, history of Somalia, the geographical aspects of Somalia, and the strategical importance of Somalia. With this, we come to the end of news article discussion sessions. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the next session, which is the practice questions discussion session. This question is based on Anglo-Maratha wars. We have to choose the incorrect statement. The first statement states, Chhatrapati Shivaji led Maratha forces in the first Anglo-Maratha war. This statement is wrong because Shivaji lived from 1627 to 1680. And as we know, he was the founder of Maratha kingdom. And he was a contemporary of Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb. That is, they both existed in the same period. But if you see the Anglo-Maratha wars, they were fought between 1777 to 1818. And these wars were fought between British East India Company and the Maratha Confederacy. So this statement is wrong. So the final answer should contain statement 1. So you can eliminate option A and option C. Now the next statement states, one of the reasons for Anglo-Maratha wars is the growing influence of the British East India Company in the internal affairs of the Maratha Confederacy. This statement is correct because it was one of the reasons. And along with this, there were other reasons also, such as the British greed for territorial expansion and also to check the power of Marathas. The wars were fought. So this second statement is correct, which means it should not be in the final answer. So we can eliminate option D also. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 1 and 3 only. Now let us see why third option is incorrect. Bhima Koregaon battle was part of the third battle of Panipat in which Maratha forces were defeated. Now remember that the third battle of Panipat happened in 1761, but this Bhima Koregaon battle happened in 1818. So if you know the years, you can simply say this is a wrong statement. Or else you can easily remember that Bhima Koregaon battle was a part of third Anglo-Maratha war and not the third battle of Panipat. And also remember that in this Bhima Koregaon battle, the Dalit dominated British troops defeated the Peshwa army. And to commemorate this victory day, the British built a memorial pillar also, which is known as Koregaon Ranstamb or Vijay Stamb. Now, this next question is based on River Kaveri. The first statement states, it originates in the Brahmagiri Hills in the Western Ghats and it is an intrastate river. Now, the first half of this statement is correct. It originates in the Brahmagiri Hills of Western Ghats only, which is situated in Kodagu district of Karnataka. But it is not an intrastate river. It is an interstate river. Intrastate means it flows within the state itself, but Kaveri flows from Karnataka to Tamil Nadu. So it is an interstate river and not an intrastate river. So this statement is wrong. Here the question asks for the correct statement. So you can eliminate option A and C because it contains statement 1. Then the second statement states, the Grand Aqueduct located in Kaveri was originally built by Chola King Karigalan. Now, even if you don't know whether this is correct or not, looking at the options, you can say it is correct because the remaining options B and D both contain 2. So, this is a correct statement. The third statement states, Arkavati, Bhavani and Noyil are its tributaries. This statement is also correct. Arkavati is an important left bank tributary of Kaveri and Bhavani and Noyil are right bank tributaries. So, the final correct answer to this question is option B, 2 and 3 only. Now, this next question is based on Swachh Sarvekshan. The first statement states, it is a nationwide survey to rank cities and villages based on various sanitation and cleanliness parameters. Now, this statement is wrong because it is a nationwide survey to rank cities only, not villages. Here, the question asks for the incorrect statement. Here, first statement is incorrect. So, you can eliminate option C because it does not contain statement 1. And you can also eliminate option D because it mentions none of the above. That means all the above statements are correct. This is also wrong because statement 1 is wrong. Now, coming to the second statement, it is conducted by Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs under Government of India. This statement is a correct statement. By looking at the option, you can easily say the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 only. And the third statement is correct because the concept of continuous survection has been introduced in Swachh Sarvekshan 2020 only. Now, this next question is based on geography. It asks, Somalia has common borders with Ethiopia, Djibouti and Eritrea, Ethiopia, Djibouti and Kenya, Ethiopia, Uganda and South Sudan, Kenya, Uganda and South Sudan. Now, if you see, all these countries are situated in the east part of African continent. And from this map, you can easily say that Eritrea does not share borders with Somalia and so does South Sudan and Uganda. So, the correct answer is Ethiopia, Djibouti and Kenya. Now, let us see one mains question based on GS paper 2. Not just the government, but each and every one of us are under constitutional and moral obligation to preserve community resources. Elaborate. Now, to answer this question, first you can define what do we mean by community resources. Then you can talk about the constitutional provisions which mentions that it is a moral obligation for the government and for the people to preserve community resources. So, you can mention about Article 51, capital A, clause G. Then you can mention about Article 48A, which discusses about the duty of the government in this regard. Then you can talk about the fundamental right of Article 21, which is about right to life. So, it encompasses right to decent environment, including pollution-free water and air, right to livelihood, etc. And you can also mention about the recent Supreme Court judgment, which we discussed today, in which the Supreme Court has stressed the fact that it is necessary to preserve community resources for the overall welfare of the community, especially for the welfare of the poor. With this, we have come to the end of news article discussion sessions and the practice questions discussion session. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.